Well, welcome everyone. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Jack Spraga. It's my privilege to serve as president of this great institution. At some point, Senator Robert Byrd of West Virginia engineered a congressional piece of legislation to mandate, really, that we celebrate the Constitution. September 17th is the date that the Constitution was approved by all 12 delegations, not Rhode Island, in 1787. And he thought that, apparently, Senator Byrd and others thought that it was a good idea to have a day set aside or a moment set aside to celebrate that. Now, September 17th, as you know, this is not September 17th. It was Saturday. So we're taking Monday to celebrate the occasion. And I wanted to introduce, before we get started, Janet LaBelle from Senator Kerry's office. Janet, would you just raise your hand? She's offered to be with us. We invited Senator Kerry and Senator Kennedy, but unfortunately their schedules are also full, as we invited Congressman McGovern. Just a couple of things for you. There are copies of the, those of you who have not memorized the Constitution yet, there are copies available for you. I dug into my old history course notes. They're not too yellow yet, and a couple of handouts. One is the outline of the Constitution and a summary of the Constitution. I'll give you a quick bird's eye view of how the Constitution is organized, and the summary of the amendments that have come forward over the years through the Constitution. And also dates to remember in that critical period of 1787 to 1791. There'll be a test after this session. This was one of my favorite essay questions when I taught, was the comparison of the powers of the Articles of Confederation, which you will instantly recall was the government of the United States before the Constitution. Comparison of the powers under the Articles of Confederation, and also compared to the powers and the authority under the present Constitution that we have. So, great essay question, absolutely great essay question. I want to also, just a couple of introductory thoughts. The format of the session will be that Congressman McGovern, whom I will introduce in a few minutes, will make a presentation. And we are fortunate to have two faculty members, Professor Maureen Soa and Professor Barry McKee, to respond, or I call them first responders, to comments about the Constitution, and then we will open it up for questions and answers. Congressman McGovern graciously agreed to stay a while. I've warned him that some of you may be leaving to get to your next class. Well, the celebration of the Constitution, a living document, not just something that happened 200-odd years ago in Philadelphia. Someone once told me that the first written reference to a written constitution is in the Bible, a book of Nehemiah. I'm not sure if that's true or not, but whenever any group gets together, they have to decide on the rules and the regulations, how are we going to live, right? Who takes out the garbage, right? Who does this? Who does that? Who does the shopping? So when you put them in writing, you have essentially a compact or a constitution. And it's not something, as I say, this is the point I wanted to emphasize to you, is that it's not something that just happened 200 years ago in Philadelphia. We see it regularly, and in fact, just recently we see it. It's still an issue in Katrina, the devastation and the horrific experience. We see, I don't know if we saw it at work, but we saw federal, state, and local, the federal system coming into play. Now, whether or not it worked exactly as Madison and Monroe envisioned in terms of the governor of Louisiana and the mayor of New Orleans and the president of the United States, that's another matter, but it is a federated system. So Katrina, in Iraq, we see the struggles to produce a written constitution. And of course, it's complicated by the fact that a war was fought. But if I always say, Saddam Hussein had resigned and just went to live in Miami Beach the rest of his life and no war had been fought, it's still a struggle to put a constitution together. And you have Shiites and Sunnis and Kurds. You have regional divisions. You had, in this country, you had Northerners and Westerners and Southerners all. And different views of what a government should be. Should it be a strong government? Should it be a states' rights, more in the states, more at the local level? Those are all issues that we see. So we saw it in Katrina. We see it in Iraq. If you've been watching, as I have, on C-SPAN, the Chief Justice nomination hearings, you get all of these constitutional cases coming before. Just in the last week or so, Judge Roberts, he had to respond to questions about Marbury versus Madison, McCulloch versus Maryland, Griswold case, the Brown case, the Plessy Ferguson case. There are just a number of key Supreme Court cases, Roe versus Wade. All these are still with us today as we talk about the evolution of the Constitution and the interpretation of the Constitution, changes over periods. Those of you old enough to remember way back in 2000, the year 2000, the election of 2000, and what in the heck was the Electoral College all about, and why was Florida so important, and all those hanging chads, what was so vital about that, and the Supreme Court moving in to make a decision about that election, all bringing into play the various pieces of the Constitution. Compromise is the key word in the Constitution. They had to brought together a number of people. Remember, Rhode Island didn't even sign it at the time. They had such reservations about certain things, slavery and the power to tax and Bill of Rights. Wanted the Bill of Rights first, not afterwards. So all of these things come into play, and it's just a wonderful exercise. Just to theoretically think, if you were going to form a group, just this group in this room, if we were going to live together in a certain area of the city, how would we govern ourselves? How would we decide who does what, and whether we'd elect a president or a king, or how would that work? And those are all questions that those people grappled with in Philadelphia in 1787. Well, I want to introduce to you now, so we're so lucky to have our speaker from Congress, from Massachusetts, our congressional representative, James P. McGovern. He's in his fifth year in Congress. He was first sworn in 1997, way back then. He has been elected by his New England colleagues to the House Democratic Leadership Team as a regional whip. Congressman McGovern is the second-ranking Democrat on the powerful House Rules Committee. Again, the rules, how are you going to organize yourself? Before his election to Congress, Mr. McGovern spent 14 years working as a senior aide to the late U.S. Representative John Moakley, a legend, really, in his own time, and continues to be just a powerful force. He was chairman of the House Rules Committee at the time. And he, in Congress, Congressman McGovern has championed several education initiatives, including a bill to increase grant assistance for college students and their families. He has led the fight to provide adequate health care, including home health care. He has worked to increase funding for the Land and Water Conservation Fund. He has fought to preserve and strengthen Social Security. And he's secured millions of dollars in federal assistance to central and southeastern Massachusetts. Bristol Community College is the beneficiary of some of that, of some of his great work to secure federal funding, and we're always the beneficiary of his great guidance and advice as he works tirelessly to promote education in general, higher education in even more particular, and even more especially Bristol Community College. We have a great friend in Congressman James McGovern. It's my honor to introduce him to you today. Congressman James McGovern.
Well, I want to thank the President for the generous introduction and for the history lesson. Quite frankly, I feel I should be sitting there and listening to you give a lecture on the Constitution and what it means to this country. I understand that earlier today, my friend and colleague Barney Frank appeared before a similar gathering at New Bedford, and did very much about what I'm going to do right now. I'm sure it was informative and probably more entertaining than I'm going to be, but I'll do my humble best to try to be good and try to be brief, because I think it's better for us to have kind of an interaction. I am truly honored by the invitation to speak with you today as we collectively observe the historic final meeting of the Constitutional Convention and honor the 39 delegates who endorsed our country's Constitution on September 17, 1787. Now, I happen to believe strongly that it is important that we do so. And I think we do best by engaging in the kind of discussion that we're about to have. This forum is a reflection of precisely what the framers of the Constitution intended nearly 220 years ago, a nation where an open and honest exchange of ideas would occur freely among its citizens. The fact that those very same delegates to the Constitutional Convention were able to devise a document in less than 4 months that to this very day provides the structure for the advancement and the protection of such a noble ideal is absolutely an extraordinary achievement. The Constitution is the bedrock of our entire democracy, and it continues to serve as the best model for governance of free people all around the world. I mean, our Constitution is what other nations use as a basis to develop their own constitutions. As I've already said, I think it's important that we pay tribute to that extraordinary achievement every year, but it seems especially so this year in light of current events. As all of you know, the Senate's Judiciary Committee is presently interviewing John Roberts, the President's nominee to replace Justice Rehnquist as Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. You also, no doubt, are aware that the President will soon be nominating another Justice of the Supreme Court to replace retiring Justice Sandra Day O'Connor. I must confess that I'm just a little horrified that George Bush is going to be able to appoint two justices to the Supreme Court. But anyway, that's what we have to deal with. But ever since Congress established the Supreme Court in 1789, that august body has been responsible for interpreting our sacred Constitution as well as the laws and treaties of the United States. Now, as we speak, there is a debate raging in our country as to whether the Supreme Court and, frankly, many of the other federal circuit and district courts have overstepped the authority conferred upon them under Article 3 of the Constitution. There is no shortage of accusations being hurled back and forth about activist judges who are imposing their own will rather than applying the law and the Constitution. Some have gone as far as to say that the judicial branch of government has violated the separation of powers by systematically overturning laws passed by Congress. However, it bears noting that not much of this is really new. There has been a long philosophical divide in our country over the issue of whether the Constitution must be strictly construed according to the explicit language of the document or more broadly interpreted. I don't profess to know which side of the debate is right, but I will try to briefly offer my opinion on what that means for our Constitution in the 21st century. Now, let me begin by stating that the framers of the Constitution were brilliant and brave men. However, they were not mystics, and they could not have envisioned the world that we now live in. The 21st century has brought us issues, challenges, and struggles that would have been inconceivable to the delegates to the Constitutional Convention. We grapple today with things that were beyond the scope of imagination 10 years ago, never mind 210 years ago. The World Wide Web and stem cell research are just two new frontiers that not even Benjamin Franklin, despite his vision and intellect, could have thought possible. Today, we are confronted with complex constitutional questions, which I think demand answers beyond a purely literal reading of the Constitution. For example, does the Second Amendment, quote, right to keep and bear arms, end quote, really extend to include all assault weapons? And does the right to privacy from government intrusion derived from the Fourth Amendment really extend limitlessly from the computer in my home into cyberspace? I mean, these are tough questions, and the answers can't be easily reduced to a simple reading of the words on a page. John Marshall, is widely regarded as the greatest Chief Justice in the history of the Supreme Court, having served the longest tenure of any Chief Justice to date. He served for fully 34 years as Chief Justice from 1801 until his death in 1835. And he is most often credited with establishing the Supreme Court as a co-equal branch of government through his many judicial opinions, most notably Marbury versus Madison, which enunciated the principle of judicial review. It was Chief Justice Marshall who once said, and I quote, "A constitution intended to endure for ages to come is consequently to be adapted to the various crises of human affairs," end quote. And not surprisingly, I happen to share Justice Marshall's view that the Constitution is a living, breathing thing and not a dated, dormant relic of our nation's history. However, the very difficult job of adapting the Constitution to the various crises of human affairs, as Justice Marshall described, is not a job for the Supreme Court alone. In our democracy, all of us have a duty to participate in our government and to exercise our civil liberties and our civil rights. We all share the burden of deciding what human affairs require our Constitution to be adapted or even in some cases amended. And I want to close today by citing a few specific present day instances where I personally believe our Constitution is in jeopardy of being improperly adapted and possibly amended. First of all, as all of you know, Congress enacted a number of laws following the terrible terrorist attacks that we suffered on September 11, 2001. Among those was a joint resolution giving the President of the United States broad authority to use all necessary and appropriate force against those nations, organizations, and persons he determines planned, authorized, committed, or aided in the terrorist attacks that occurred on September 11, 2001. Additionally, Congress passed the Patriot Act to give the government expanded surveillance powers to combat terrorism, and just recently authorized 14 of the 16 provisions of that act that were due to expire this year. Now, let me say to you up front that I opposed the war in Iraq, and I think that Congress, by giving the President such broad authority, actually abrogated its constitutional responsibility, because Congress, under the Constitution, needs to declare war. What Congress did here was give the President this huge power, a sweeping power, to do whatever he wants without having to go to Congress to look for a formal declaration. I think Congress erred by doing that. I think Congress should have demanded that if the President wanted to go to war in Iraq or any place else, that he come back to Congress and ask for specific approval to declare war. And this is not the first time we've had this problem with presidents going to war without getting the Congress to formally declare war. But it's something that I think those of us who care about the Constitution need to insist happen. Now, even though I opposed the war, I think that at the time when the President went to war, the public opinion polls showed it was pretty popular, so probably a majority of members of Congress would have given him the vote to go to war. I wouldn't have, but I think he would have gotten it. But I think it's important that Congress insist that its prerogatives be protected, and I think it's important that the President defer to Congress when it is appropriate. I also voted against the Patriot Act as well, which I think is a very dangerous piece of legislation that I think threatens many of your constitutional rights. We can spend hours discussing my reasons for those votes, but suffice it to say that I believe that the Patriot Act, in addition, violates our right to privacy and, more importantly, diminishes our democracy. Now, I'm not a constitutional law scholar. I'm not an academic. I'm not a president of a college, or I'm not a professor. But I believe that democracy requires courage. I think that's an important thing for us to remember. Now, you know, we can all agree that we need to do better in terms of monitoring terrorists, and both in this country and abroad. But all those terrible events of September 11th should not fundamentally change us as a country. And we could put ankle bracelets on every single person in this country, and we could put surveillance cameras in every one of your homes and in every one of your classrooms. And we could tap, wiretap all of your phones. But if we did that, would America still be America? I mean, if we went to those extremes, we probably could find out everything you were doing. And if you were planning something bad, we probably could get to you before you did anything bad. That's what I mean when I say democracy requires some courage. Because if we went to that extreme and we began to invade your privacy, the bottom line is then our uniqueness as a country, you know, what makes America special gets eroded. You know, would we still be a nation, you know, where civil liberties are cherished if we continue to go down the road of the Patriot Act? I mean, Governor Romney, just the other day you may have read, you know, giving a speech before a right-wing think tank in Washington, you know, talked about the need to wiretap mosques and religious institutions, you know, as a way to combat terrorism. Well, I think that's a dumb idea. You know, just as dumb as, you know, the wiretapping a church or a synagogue. I mean, you know, if we go down that road, then you're going to be suspect by virtue of whom you worship or where you worship. Again, you know, the people that came to Massachusetts, the pilgrims that came to Massachusetts, in large part came here because they wanted to flee religious persecution. You know, let's not, you know, in the face of the terrorist attacks or in the face of trying to win elections, start to promote religious persecution in this country. And I think that's the road you go down when you start to say things like that. Just last week, the U.S. Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals upheld the president's authority to detain this fellow named Jose Padilla, who was a United States citizen. Let me repeat that for emphasis: a United States citizen. They upheld the president's authority to detain him indefinitely. Now, Padilla has been held for 3 years without a trial. The government alleges that he has associated with Al Qaeda, and therefore has been declared an enemy combatant. Now, it is certainly quite possible that Mr. Padilla is everything the government says he is, and worse. However, he has not received due process. He has not received a trial in 3 years, and he is an American citizen. This is a guy who was arrested in Chicago, not on the battlefield in Afghanistan or Iraq, and it seems to me that he has been denied the due process of law which he is entitled to under our Constitution. That fact alone should trouble all of us as Americans. No matter what kind of crime you commit, no matter how horrible you are, under our Constitution, you are entitled to due process. And now we're moving down this road where we're now declaring certain members of our country, certain members of our nation who are citizens, that they are somehow to be separated from their constitutional rights. Let me finally say that I want to talk about one other area, and I think it's relevant here in Massachusetts because we've been talking a lot about it. But this is another instance where I think our Constitution is in jeopardy. And it strikes very close to home here in Massachusetts, where we have been the center of the national debate over gay marriage. Now, notwithstanding the newly certified ballot question to amend our state constitution to ban gay marriage, there is also an effort underway nationally to amend our federal constitution for the same purpose. The President of the United States has said he supports an amendment to the Constitution to ban gay marriage. In my opinion, that idea runs contrary to the history of our country and the underlying purpose of our Constitution, which has been about the expansion of civil rights and civil liberties. I cannot, for the life of me, fathom amending our Constitution to deny or exclude a particular group of citizens from enjoying the benefits of marriage. Gay marriage just doesn't strike me as kind of the crisis of human affairs that Justice Marshall described as warranting an adaptation of our Constitution. It certainly hasn't created a crisis here in Massachusetts, where same-sex couples have been getting married for nearly a year and a half, And as far as I can tell, the world hasn't stopped on its axis. The sky hasn't fallen in. Everybody continues to go about their life pretty much the same. So I'm hopeful that as other states follow suit and embrace gay marriage as a civil rights issue, efforts to amend our federal constitution to prohibit it will subside. We have never amended the Constitution to add a discrimination, and that's what this would be. And I'll tell you, no matter what your position on gay marriage is, and I happen to support it, but no matter what your position is, you should be involved in fighting a federal constitution, a constitutional amendment. It denigrates our Constitution. It cheapens it. It brings it down to a more kind of a political type of document, and that's not what we want. So in closing, I just want to reiterate how grateful I am for the chance to be here with all of you and for your courteous attention. I'm looking forward to the experts giving their response, and then after that to your questions. So thank you very much.
Wow, that was wonderful. Thank you, Congressman McGovern. We have it set up now. The structure is that we would have two faculty respond, not necessarily respond, but give their some of their thoughts about the Constitution, and then we will open it up to your questions and answers. And first faculty member I'd like to introduce to you is our professor of history, Professor Maureen Soa.
Good morning. Thank you all for coming. Thank you again, Representative McGovern. Wonderful comments. I think Mr. McGovern hit a key issue, and that is the issue between strict constructionist, or literal interpretation of the Constitution, and the more modern interpretive approach to the Constitution. Several justices have argued that strict constructionism forces lawyers to tie their argument to the original framework of the Constitution. Now, we have to acknowledge that this is an amazing document, this Constitution. It was written in 1787 when this country was 13 small, predominantly agricultural. 93% of all wealth was agricultural. Today, this country is 50 states stretching across 3,000 miles of ocean on our western borders, up at the Arctic Circle with Alaska. It is post-industrial now. So how can a constitution that was written almost 220 years ago for a tiny, what today we would call a third or fourth world country, still function today with only 27 amendments? That's an amazing accomplishment. And it functions because across the scope of those 220 years, those who have sat on the Supreme Court have analyzed and interpreted the Constitution in the light of the period in which the questions appeared. My favorite example in classroom, and I must say, Dr. Sebrega, your favorite question? Anybody who's had a course with me in History 13 has had to answer that question for the midterm. My favorite example in class is the Plessy versus Ferguson decision from 1896. Now that's 40 years to the day after the Civil War. African Americans had been freed from slavery for over 40 years. And yet there was still segregation in the South. Plessy brought a lawsuit about equal transportation. And the Supreme Court, hearing the case on appeal, ruled that separate, if equal, was constitutional. 50 years later, in 1954, the Supreme Court heard the last of a number of civil rights cases to appear before it. The only thing that had changed was World War II, African Americans fighting in large numbers, honorably in the armed forces, While it was segregated, by the way, the armed forces had been desegregated by the courage of a Democratic President Harry Truman by executive order, and the Supreme Court looked at the issue of separate, if equal, as constitutional again and said, no. Separate is inherently unequal. What had changed? What had changed, folks, is we had changed. So the supreme law of this land, the U.S. Constitution, must be interpreted in the light of the transformations in American society. And I could stand up here forever and talk about the Constitution, but I'm not going to use up my time. I'll pass it to Professor McKee.
Thank you, Professor Sola. And our next speaker is Professor Barry McKee of the Criminal Justice Program. We're going to try the microphones on the table to save time from getting up and not, and we'll see how it works. Thanks.
How's it working so far? Excellent. one of the problems I encounter with the longer I study is that every time somebody says something, I say, oh yeah, I want to talk about that, I want to talk about this, so this could take a while. But the issue of Plessy versus Ferguson and Brown versus Board of Education is something that comes up in my class constantly. But something Congressman McGovern said struck me very seriously about gay rights. I've talked about this many, many times, and I believe that if you don't like vanilla ice cream, don't eat it. But don't tell other people they can't. The Gay Rights Amendment is something that I've never heard it quite put this way, and I'm glad you said it that way. It is something negative. It would be the first thing that goes into our Constitution that discriminates against somebody. I think that's a horrible thing to do. But anyway, what was behind us was the flag and the first few words of the preamble to our Constitution, we the people. The preamble of our Constitution is one sentence. We have the shortest Constitution in history and the most long enduring, over 200 years. But Linda Monk has written several books on the Constitution. One of his fascinating book called Words We Live By analyzes the Constitution almost line by line and article by article, but begins with looking at the first line of the preamble, we the people, and says, which people were we talking about then? Indians or Native Americans? No. Well, they were considered in its best light a sovereign nation, and in the true light, not worthy of citizenship, so they didn't count. African Americans or slaves? We had just decided that it took 5 African Americans to become 3 human beings, so they didn't count. That was only for representation. Women were property. They didn't count. The people who did count were actually the wealthy, the landowners, and even some educated people, but not all the wealthy were educated. So the beginning of our Constitution, which I think is a marvelous document, began with an idea that has evolved over time to not exclude but include. And one of the modern changes in the Constitution, a modern interpretation of the Constitution that I just wanted to mention here, comes in the Fifth Amendment of the Constitution. Most people understand the Fifth Amendment requires that the government cannot compel you to testify against yourself. Well, it also includes a section on due process, which the Supreme Court has said represents a profound attitude of fairness. And there's also a clause in there called the Takings Clause, where the government has the right to take your property. But, I'll read just a little section where it says, nor shall any person be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor shall private property, be taken for public use without just compensation. Well, one of the more recent decisions of the Supreme Court now, or issues before it, is an eminent domain. Does the government, certainly does local government, have the right to take your property for its own use? The intention originally was, I believe, that if my house were in a place where they needed to build a school and there was no better place in town, that they could tell me, we'll give you just compensation for your home, but you have to move. Well, the Kelo versus New London, Connecticut, 2005 case was a 5-4 decision of the Supreme Court that allowed the taking of 15 homes, those were 15 people who fought it, it was actually 115 homes, to allow a private pharmaceutical company to build a factory. They took people's homes to let private industry build a factory. Their argument was that these homes paid X amount of dollars in taxes, and there was unemployment in the area. But this pharmaceutical company would employ most, if not all, of those people and provide a greater tax base for the community. So is it a better or a greater good to the community? The Fifth Amendment said the government shall take for public use, not private use. Interesting issue, and by the way, the Supreme Court decided in favor of big business. The precedent cases, there's just two precedent cases, and I'll let you think this one over. Berman versus Parker was a 1954 case from Washington, D.C. Mm-hmm. And in that case, they decided that the city could purchase at a reasonable price an entire neighborhood and demolish it because it was run down, high crime, and it was no benefit to society, and to build housing there that would benefit society. And the other case was Hawaii Housing Authority versus Cadiff in 1984. And the Hawaii Housing Authority took large sections of privately owned land in Hawaii, but the land was owned by a handful of big business corporations who were essentially, not intentionally, but essentially creating an underclass in those areas, in places where people could not own homes. So the government took that under just compensation and allowed it for private homes to be built. Are those the same as what is happening in Connecticut, where people's homes, 115 homes were purchased, 15 people fought it and lost, those homes were taken by the government for private industry? How has our Constitution evolved? Many, many good ways, sometimes not so good ways. What do you think?
Well, I'm going to jump in on that one. I think that the protection of private property is one of the cardinal protections in the Constitution. The founders and the political philosophers of the early years would argue that a man without private property, or a man with property, a human being with property that could be taken without just compensation, is a human being who does not have freedom. And so I think it's an extraordinarily dangerous precedent. I think what we're seeing is the economic exigencies of the 21st century, where local municipalities and local governments are under stress because of unfunded mandates that have descended on them from the state level, from the federal level, and they're looking at any way to raise money. Chief Justice Souter, an alleged conservative justice, but he's more moderate, middle of the road from New Hampshire, voted with the 5 majority on this case. Apparently, a lawyer who's a constructionist, he has a construction company, has brought a request before the town board of selectmen to take a large proportion of Justice Souter's property in New Hampshire to build a resort hotel, a resort condominium. We shall see what's going to happen with this. They keep tabling it because this is one of those hot potatoes that no one wants to touch with a barge pole. I was interested. Mr. McGovern was talking about, and I do agree with you about the Constitution being in jeopardy with the Patriot Act. I think that's Benjamin Franklin said, a person who's willing to give up freedom for a little bit of protection or security, is what Franklin said, deserves neither in the end. And I think the Patriot Act, although it's designed allegedly to keep us safe, is actually extraordinarily dangerous. I would frankly like to see the Congress of the United States stand up to the presidents who want to declare war without a constitutional declaration of war and invoke the War Powers Act, which was designed after Vietnam to force a discussion of the commitment of American troops into combat. And no one, from the president to the Congress, has wanted to approach this act because it is a constitutional hot potato. Is it constitutional because it limits the president's authority as commander-in-chief? Or is it, is it unconstitutional because it limits the president's authority as commander-in-chief? Or is it constitutional because it reflects the Congress's authority in war making? You know, but anyway, I would really like to see that happen.
Thank you. We have a bit of time left. Yeah. The Congressman has kindly consented to answer any of your questions. It's going to be a little difficult with the, we have microphones here and over here. It might be helpful if you had a question to come down. In the meantime, we'll take a question by hand to save some time. If you have a question, please do come to the mic, but let's get started with one from your seat. Way up in the back, Professor Pushaw.
I heard affirmative action. What was the first thing? How do I feel about
affirmative action?
Yeah, I have supported affirmative action, and I agree that to this day there are significant racial divisions in this country. I think anybody who has been watching the TV in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina can see with their own eyes that the incredible poverty in this country, and that. Most of the people left behind were African American. And, you know, whether there's a conscience, policy, you know, going on to discriminate, the bottom line is people are being discriminated against in this country. And all men are created equal. All men and women are created equal. We've evolved in this country where we proclaim that there are no second-class citizens. That's our rhetoric. That's what we believe, supposedly. And yet there are. Can affirmative action be better carried out? Probably. I'm not one of these people who believe that we should end it. And I think it has worked pretty well, by and large. So that's my response.
Thank you. Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
But they didn't mandate what we have to discuss.
Right.
So it doesn't violate the freedom of speech.
Maureen, could you just repeat the question in case people...
Sorry. The question was, is the fact that this particular gathering is a reflection of a federal mandate to have a Constitution Day to celebrate the Constitution a violation of the Constitution? Which is a great question. It says gather to discuss the Constitution, but it doesn't say what we have to say. I mean, if I wanted to, I could stand up here, I guess, and say Thomas Jefferson was a fascist. Because that's not proscribed. No one's telling us what to say. So it's a great question, but I don't think it's a violation of the Constitution.
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, I agree with the professor. Congress passes a lot of mandates, by the way. And they need to fund those mandates. That's one of the things that's not in the Constitution, but I wish it was. Let me just also say that I think part of the reason why Senator Byrd thought this was a good idea is because there are a lot of people who I don't think appreciate the magnificence of this document. And I think, you know, and I think one of the things that people get concerned about, quite frankly, is that if you don't appreciate the magnificence of this document, you don't appreciate the importance of being involved in your community. I mean, you just had an election here in Fall River, and the turnout was pretty low. You know, and that's not unique. It's you know, and I think part of the deal is that I think people need to come to appreciate, you know, what the rights of every person, what the rights are that every person can have in this country, and just the importance of kind of beginning to appreciate how vital it is for you to be involved, you know, in local affairs and state affairs and in federal affairs.
Thank you. We have Professor Pollack. One more, we could take one more question if someone would like to come down to the microphone.
On?
Professor Pollack, is it on?
This is on. Hello?
Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
I just wondered, Congressman McGovern, why do you think that Congress did not declare war if, in fact, Bush would have gotten the declaration? Why didn't they go through the constitutional process?
Well, that's a good question. Because part of the deal, I think what ended up happening is that Congress, quite frankly, was intimidated by the president. You know, after you know, when he asked us to, when he asked for this broad, sweeping power to do whatever he wants to do, wherever he wants to do, invade whoever he wants, no questions asked. When he asked for this huge power, again, you know, people were still reeling in the aftermath of September 11th. The public opinion polls said that, you know, 70% of people think the president should be able to do whatever he wants to do. And so, you know, I got to tell you, I mean, being a member of Congress or being a member of the United States Senate, you know, courage is not a prerequisite. You know, some of us tried to make the case that, look, don't ask us for this sweeping authority. You know, if you want to go to war, then you come and say, I'm going to war. You tell us when you're going to go to war. Congress passed this resolution in October, and we didn't go to war until, I think, March, if I remember correctly. And, you know, I think the president didn't want to do this because he didn't want another debate. He didn't want people to ask questions like, you know, are we prepared? You know, where's the evidence? I think he figured, you know, it's easier for him not to have to deal with Congress, but to be able to do whatever he wants to do at any time. And I think that was a mistake. I really do. You know, it's kind of a repeat of Vietnam and with the Gulf of Tonkin resolution. You know, Congress going along, and trust me, I won't do anything without consulting you. And it turns out you give the president this sweeping authority to be able to do anything he wants. So I think it was a lack of political courage. I think a lack of appreciating what Congress's constitutional responsibilities really are. It's a bad precedent. It's a bad precedent. And I hope we've learned, you know, I keep on saying that you like to learn from your mistakes, but I hope never, ever, ever again, I don't care who the president is and I don't care what the war is, that we go to war without going to Congress and asking for a formal declaration.
Thank you. One last question, Jane.
Hello. I'd like to ask a little bit more about the Supreme Court's recent ruling about the New London case. As a property owner, this concerns me, but what interested me about the case was, as I understand it, it wasn't actually the private pharmaceutical company who was bringing the case. It was this quasi-government agency, the New London Development Council. And when the majority ruled in favor of them, they included an opinion that said the states have the right to pass laws against this particular taking. So the New London Development Authority sent eviction notices to the homeowners, and the governor got very angry. Apparently the governor doesn't support this, and she wants time to examine the situation and figure out if she can pass a rule against this and force them to rescind the eviction letters. I'm curious to understand how this conflict can arise within the state government. If the New London Development Authority is a public agency, how could they even get to the Supreme Court without the state government's support, and if they're not really a public authority, how do they have the right to bring the case against the private homeowners in the first place?
Well, actually, wasn't the company that brought people to the court of the Supreme Court, it was the 15 people who refused to sell, who were issued evicted notice. They said it's not fair. The state said, yes, it is, and they appealed it to the Supreme Court. And that's where the Supreme Court looked at the issue, and five of them decided that the public good, as in more taxes, more jobs, outweighed the private citizens' rights of homeownership.
State supported this, then why is the governor apparently fighting this effort now? That's where my confusion lies.
Because the governor's not the state. The state is the legislative authority.
Which
implies part of the government, but okay. They empower the municipalities along the general regulations of each of the states. Now remember, we are a federated republic. That means that different states have different rules and different regulations and different controls over their municipalities. I live in New Hampshire. The state legislature wouldn't dare, except in the most broad ways, try to tell the municipalities what to do.
We have to move. Everyone's got to leave for their 12 o'clock class. We do have one last question here.
I just wanted to ask, how can we, we have the freedom of expression, but how can we still show respect for one another when we disagree with what you expressed? Like, I disagreed when you expressed about you were horrified that Bush has the, potential to put another Supreme Court justice in. And, I was afraid to put a Bush-Cheney sticker on my car here in Massachusetts. I thought, sure, my car would be keyed. So how can we have, without being called stupid because I voted for Bush when someone else didn't, how can we still get along well and show respect for one another even though we disagree with each other?
Well, I think by doing what you just said, I'm expressing an honest impulse that I have. I am not at all pleased with the prospect of putting people on the Supreme Court who may overturn decisions like Roe v. Wade, who may rule on civil rights cases in a way that will deny people basic civil liberties and civil rights. That is horrifying to me. I respect the president. I respect people who voted for George Bush and Dick Cheney. And people have different opinions. One of the great things about this country is that I could say what I just said and not be taken off to jail, or not be shot. And that's the way it is. People get along and disagree. I will tell you that on a personal level, I get along with the president. He's a nice person. Politically and kind of ideologically and philosophically, I have never disagreed with the president more in my lifetime. And that's me. And I'm sure if he were here, he would say, as a member of Congress, there's nobody I disagree with more than someone like Jim McGovern. But I think you're getting to another issue, which is something that we need to work at here, and that is, being able to say to one another that, if you have a different opinion than me, that you're not stupid. If you have a different opinion than me, you don't have a bad character. If you have a different opinion than me, civil discourse. We're kind of losing here. You look at our presidential campaigns, and they have this is the greatest, the candidates are the greatest classroom and the greatest pulpit in the world. And they become, about people's, and they become smear campaigns. I thought, the attack on John Kerry's war record was just reprehensible. And, I thought that the allegations of the previous campaign about George Bush's, drinking and, drinking and driving was reprehensible. Those are, they're either non-issues or they're just slime. We need to work toward it. I think you have a good point.
Speaking as a historian, mudslinging in presidential campaigns is nothing new. Andrew Jackson called John Quincy Adams a, how do I put this delicately, that he pimped for, and that's the word he used, for the Tsar of Russia. So slinging is not something brand new in political campaigns, but Representative McGovern hit the nail on the head. We need to demand as a people, why do you think mud slings in a campaign? Because it wins. Mud sticks. We need to demand as a people a higher level of civil discourse, and the only way we're going to get that is to vote, because they will listen to us if we vote. I think Senator Byrd hit the nail on the head with gatherings like this. Even though it's mandated, it's healthy for the Republic to talk about the rights we have and to disagree with them. Like, I disagree with Representative McGovern about the issue of race in New Orleans. Race is obvious because New Orleans is 80% African American. I think the bigger issue in New Orleans was poverty. I think it was poverty. And not that race doesn't count, but those who didn't get out were too poor to get out, and nobody cared. That was, to me, the issue. Anyway.
Well, thank you. We're getting to the time now. I want to thank Congressman McGovern for taking time out of his busy schedule to come to visit with us and come here and lend his expertise in constitutional matters for us. And thanks, the question's very thoughtful. And I want to thank the two faculty responders as well. We'll meet again. If it's not next September 17th, I hope it's...